Thank you, guys. So we've just had an amazing panel. We can't really do justice to AI, right, in one day. It's one of the most important topics of our, probably our lives, right? And this is not just us saying it. This is what every major thought leader is saying, right? So let me just jump in really quickly with you, Temitope. Just really quickly, can you share with us your journey, right, in AI? Especially, I know I'm jumping into this, but there are not a lot of, you know, maybe female engineers and founders in this space. And, you know, if we're starting to really focus on, you know, put a spotlight on this new technology, we want to fix it from the beginning, right? And make sure that there's that equality. So tell us a little bit about your journey, right, as a female in this industry.
Hi, everyone. I'm so glad to be here. And this building reminds me of a lot of things. I remember 5 years back, I was sitting down there. I came to listen to someone. And I'm here, sitting here. And people are listening to me. So the long and short story is, anything you think of, you can get it, you can be it, and you can even go farther than where I am today. So my journey in AI started 7 years back, but my journey in tech started 15 to 10 years. And I was so glad I waited that long, because sometimes every one of us want that microwave success. I want to be there. I want people to know me. I'm not there yet, but I'm so glad I was so patient. So 7 years back, I started with Facebook. I was just picked by Facebook and Intel for this university scholarship and stuff like that. Then when I started that scholarship, I was like, can I really stand it? Because prior to that, I was into robotics. I was into building applications using Java and stuff like that. Well, I've always wanted to build intelligent system. And how can my robot be intelligent without AI? So I got into AI like, okay, I must get it done. Because part of my mantra is undying resilience. And I just want to get it done. I don't know how it's going to happen, but I want to get it done. So I started that, baby steps, like that. After that scholarship that I did for 6 months, I actually got this offer to solve a problem for the Polish government that will influence their policy. And I was like, okay, let's give it a try. And that was on NLP. And gradually I got into AB InBev. And now I'm so glad. Looking back, I will say that I was so glad I was not on focus. So I will summarize it with 4 words. You have to be focused. You have to be gratified. You have to get mentors. There are times I felt like giving up. You are going to get that time, especially females, because that space is very small. That circle is small. So you have to get mentors around you. And the fourth thing is, you have to know that you have to just get the work done. It's not because I'm a female. It's not because I'm fine. Because I need to get the work done.
Okay, yeah. Great. I think that's super important, because one of the key things that's going to drive this is talent, right? And a lot of people right now are looking for the right talent to bring into the organizations to allow them to implement these things. And this is very important for many of the founders here. Just moving on to you, Adebowale. So, you know, you build sort of, you have an all-in-one sort of insurance infrastructure, right, that you put out there for startups. Sounds kind of complex, right? So can you elaborate on how your startup utilizes AI and machine learning to streamline that process, right, for startups? What are the key benefits of this approach that you're taking using AI?
All right. Hello, everyone. Thank you for having me. So primarily when we build solutions in-house, and I say this all the time, we always look at this from a problem-solving perspective as against building something fanciful, right? And to do this, you really need to engage those who have the problems. Yeah. So for us, in trying to build this digital insurance infrastructure, we have to first engage the stakeholders, which in this case are legacy insurance companies, right? So what are your pain points? What are the inefficiencies that you have within your organizations? Whether it's in terms of distribution, whether it's in terms of claims management, customer support, customer journey, and what have you. And then on the other side of that, you have the users, the end users, customers. So for us, what we did was first to break this down into three main verticals, right? Where you have product development, product design, and underwriting on the one hand. You have distribution, which is how do you get these products to the end user faster, cheaper. And then you have claims management and operational processes for insurance companies as the third layer. So for us, using technology first and then artificial intelligence is primarily addressing the inefficiencies in these three different verticals. So first, in product underwriting, can we have more personalized products, right? Can the experiences and day-to-day activity of the user inform the kind of insurance products that they get as against vanilla products or off-the-shelf products? So that's one. Also, in serving that customer is, how am I able to provide 24/7 support, cheaper, faster, right, for the user? And then in terms of distribution is, can we, again, I think it was one of the panelists here that talked about collaboration. Can we collaborate with other innovators who are building in fintech and proptech in whatever industry to embed insurance into their own offerings and make access cheaper? And then, of course, on the legacy company side is making their process faster, more efficient, and then, of course, fraud-free. So, yes, in a nutshell, that's how we use it.
Yeah, I think that's super important because, customer support is one of the biggest issues, right? I think that a lot of startups, a lot of larger corporations, right? Nigerians like to talk, you might see information on the website, but you just want to talk to somebody just to get that information, right? And that puts a heavy burden on the startups or the corporations because you have to man those call centers, have that two-way communication. So if you're able to bring AI to do that in a super realistic way where it doesn't seem like canned answers, right? I think that's incredibly powerful, especially for African startups, right? So, Niyi, thanks for joining. So for me, right, somebody on the last panel mentioned how expensive AI is to sort of build on, right, as a company. I think, a lot of the people who are training models right now are using NVIDIA's most expensive, chipsets, right? And these run into like hundreds of thousands. So if you need like 10 or like 20, it's just, you're spending a lot of money, right? But you have the cloud, right? So why is the cloud important to AI and machine learning for startups, right? How does that help them? How does that help them get running right now when they're not a multi-billion dollar company?
Thank you very much. That's an interesting question. And this resonates very well with me because I'm a cloud engineer and I'm a data engineer also. And in addition to that, I'm also a consultant, which means I've gotten the opportunity to sit down with a lot of founders, get them talk about their problems, the solution they want to build, right, and the challenges that they are facing. And for some of them, I would have, number one, the ignorance of the existence of the cloud, right? Most people don't know that the solutions that they want to build already existed on the cloud. For instance, a founder wants to build an application, for identifying maybe different kind of custom objects in videos and all. But they think the most optimal way to do that is, I need to buy a server, put it, in my backyard and then train my custom model, deploy it on it. Or maybe I need to create the model from scratch, right? And deploy somewhere in a server running. And you agree with me that servers cost money, right? Even if you put them on the cloud, they still cost money because when you're not using them, they keep running, right? And machine learning and AI, to be fair, is expensive. It's not cheap. And one of the ways I think founders can leverage, especially startups, can leverage on this is that There are cloud providers that already built custom model as part of their services. It's integrated as a part of their services. For instance, I'm going to mention a cloud provider, AWS. Everybody knows AWS, right? So AWS has been successful in making sure that they build set of AI services. So if I am a startup and I want to build, I want my startups to maybe be able to identify custom objects in videos and all, it has already been built as a service. So I just need to pick that, retrain it as a custom model, and build it around my startups as a journey. Okay, I necessarily don't have to, go buy servers and spin up, deploy custom model, train, spend hours training, gathering data, and all of those. Okay, so, and I think the way they can overcome that is doing their research. I want to build this startup. This is what it's going to do. These are the journeys. What are services that are existing? What are services that are already out there that I can leverage on? Okay, you can't build everything custom from scratch. Otherwise, you're going to spend years and you're going to take too much time to actually go to market. So you want to do your research. What are the services that are currently existing that I can leverage on? And to the surprise of some of them, they actually realize that they have some tools that I can just pick and plug and play, okay? I don't necessarily have to maybe tweak it too much. I just have to build a journey around it and create my products, create my startup, and I'm on my way.
Exactly. Yeah. Now, I think that's on point, right? A lot of the AI startups that are, disrupting immediately out of the box are actually building on tools and solutions that are already out there, right, on the cloud. So that's something that people, here can also do as well. So Temitope, just really quickly, can you share specific examples, right, of how AI and computer vision, right, which is the ability of machines to recognize objects, right, like a chair, like a car, in video or images, right? How have those transformed the beverage manufacturing industry, right? So I ask that because a lot of times we think maybe AI is only for specific use cases, right? Like high-tech things. So what is it doing in a beer company? And how can, startup founders then leverage similar technologies in their own startups?
Okay, thanks for that question. I'll just paint it this way. I'll give you 3 KPIs that you can get from that for the beverage company. Then I'll then put a blanket spread across other companies that might be in this room that needs that idea as well. For a beverage company, everybody needs line of sight. Either Budweiser, either Trophy, either Heineken, either Betamalt or any of those. We want to know where our products are. Because if we don't have that complete line of sight, how do we make comprehensive analytics? How do we know that at Elisha, we don't have Budweiser there? So computer vision can help us drive that particular business case. That, okay, when you get to a particular place or a particular demographics or region or district, it can give you that information with just a click of a finger. Because we know that computer vision, the backbone, everything, talking about either the Tetron, PyTorch, TensorFlow, all those things that are being embedded, although you're talking about the high computing power kind of things, but still, you know that you can get visuals, pictures from those things that you can make business-informed decision on. And the second KPI that we'll also talk about is availability. Imagine going to a store. They call it psychology of sales. Because a little bit of technical management, you have to work with everybody. So if you get to a store and I can't find Budweiser on the shelf, I won't even remember I wanted to buy Budweiser. I will go for the next product because it's not there. Now imagine me sending Shea to the store to pick up Budweiser or to let me know that there's Budweiser on that shelf 24/7. Computer vision can help us with that information. Then availability or visibility, as the case may be. Because sometimes when we don't see the labels, we might not know we are also looking at trophy. For example, we have Goldberg, we have for another brand, which is now our own, our competitor brand. I am representing my company here. And we have trophy. So if the label is not showing, I'll think he's something else. So I might actually pick up another brand, and we are all here to make sales. If you are not making money, why are you in business? Either technical, either building any LLMs, either building any form of infrastructure, technical solution, everybody wants to make money. And that's why startups are here also, to make money, to make return, their ROI and all those things, it should be there, right? So all those things, we are all driving that sales. So in a nutshell, I'll summarize it like visibility, availability, and a proper line of sight, because we all need that for our businesses.
Exactly. I think it's incredibly powerful what AI is doing in your industry, right? To just streamline some of those processes. And I think that these are things that startups can start looking at over the next couple of years, right? And incorporate and learn from larger companies like yours. Just really coming to you, and I know that we're kind of running on time. So I'd say that insurance is an industry that relies heavily on data analysis, especially in markets like this, right? Where, you know, yeah, there's just a lot that, you know, you really need to be on top of data analysis and risk assessment, right? So how can AI and machine learning technologies enhance the accuracy and efficiency of the processes they use for this?
All right. Like you rightly said, insurance underwriting is heavily data reliant, and there have been different use cases all over the world. I'll give you an example of a company in the US. They do auto insurance, comprehensive insurance specifically for vehicles. And what it is that you download the app on the phone, and as long as you have that app on the phone, it sort of monitors your driving habits. And based on your driving habits, it then gives you a score. And generally it checks things like your average speed, how you negotiate sharp turns, the ease or lack of it at which you brake. And then that net score that it gives you goes into the database to sort of either increase or reduce your premium, right? I can bring that back home here and say in Lagos, right? So generally we have flat insurance rates for everybody in auto insurance. But if I live in Lekki Phase 1, the risks that I face are quite different from someone who lives in same motion. So in Lekki, I have a flood risk that might not be, you know, necessarily the case in the Bagada, for instance. And how does data factor my own peculiarity into my pricing, right? So that's how you use information that is available on everyday activity to then come up with either indexes or data points to now price premium for a particular person. But beyond that also is around claims, right? So when you track, so for instance, in terms of demography and location, where claims come from, the types of claims that come from those places, the period during which claims come as well, you can then price accordingly to say, okay, if I'm designing a product, there's a higher tendency for people maybe between 24 to 35 to have a high claims ratio, and I need to price the cost of that into that product. So that data, right, having access to that data, collecting that data effectively, and then most importantly, interpreting that data will go a long way in being able to derive useful information for pricing.
So you're saying automating insights that you can get from data, right, to customize, right, so that every single person that you're putting out your product to gets a little slice that's customized for them, exactly. Right, and their situations, and AI does that.
Yeah, that's the ideal, that's the expected, that's not our reality today, right, so just so...
Exactly. Yeah. Okay, so just really quickly, Ajayi, so when you look ahead, right, when you're thinking about machine learning and AI, what emerging trends, right, are you seeing that really startups here should be thinking about, right, when they want to capitalize on, you know, all of these futuristic opportunities we're mentioning, right? So you can look at from your background in cloud, right? What are you seeing that people here should really be thinking about?
Maybe not my background in cloud, but I'm going to pick from my background in consulting, okay? And a lot of people, they come in and they want to do fancy stuff that has already been done before, you know, nothing so special, even though they have some special use cases. But I think for emerging startups, I think where if I was to build a startup, where I would be looking is in the aspect of healthcare, right? You know, there are a lot of opportunities, there are a lot of automations that can take place in that space, you know, to actually fine-tune the way that we experience healthcare, do some form of recommendation, you know, recommend to people some form of healthcare that they can get, and maybe try to get people to do some survey on a routine, you know, for instance. At the moment now, if you go to your health checkup, you just get a recommendation from a doctor, right? But if you assess yourself very well and then you do some form of Googling, you will also get some recommendations on what might actually be happening to you. So I think if there was a startup, okay, built around that use case that gets people to do those checks and then go around, do some form of recommendation and recommend experts, you know, that can help them in, you know, taking care of themselves, recommend healthcare centers and all of those. I think that is going to be very, very fantastic. And there are a lot of several use cases that you can think of around, you know, just healthcare itself, healthcare insurance, you know, and all of those things, fancy stuff you can do around healthcare. So I think if you're looking at emerging trends, people should really be looking towards the direction of healthcare, right? And, you know, looking at nutrition, personalized health cares, majorly, I think that will present massive opportunities.
Okay. Yeah. I think you're right on the money there. I mean, that's where the money is being spent. A lot of the bigger guys, like the Microsofts and the Googles, are the next big place they're looking is actually healthcare, right? Because it's broken, actually, globally, not just in Nigeria. But, I mean, in Nigeria, we do have immense gaps, right, that AI can start helping to fill. And these are impact, not just, you know, AI for AI's sake, right? This is real impact that can really come from this technology. So I just want to thank you guys again. Thank you for an amazing panel. Please put your hands together for the speakers. And we'll be moving on to the next one. Thank you.